I have a big recollection. It was a big year on the road, too, for acts ranging from Madonna to Whitney Houston to Urge Overkill. Ticket prices reached an all-time high, and many fans were not amused.
I think it's ridiculous, man. All the kids, they can't afford to come out and see the bands.
Money.
Well, not exactly true. Ticket prices did reach new heights of inflation this year, with Madonna, for example, charging a top levy of $75 when her brief Broadway-style girly show tour passed through New York City, and ballooning production costs and performer demands pushing up prices across the board. But the kids came anyway.
You came in fever.
If you're desperate to see Madonna or anyone else, you know, you pay the price. Fair enough.
The usual suspects made the usual bundles on the road in 93, although new strategies were sometimes required. The veteran English synth-pop band Depeche Mode brandished actual drums and guitars on its U.S. tour, although the boys in the band don't want you to get the wrong idea.
No, it's only for a section of the show, it's not for the whole thing. You know, we don't want to just become just a standard rock band.
Rod Stewart hit the road unplugged this year, although his soundbite bromides were of a traditional vintage.
The actual 2 hours that you're on the stage is the most rewarding experience you could ever have. I mean, it's I wish you knew what it was like.
Once again, it's on.
What would it have been like to see Sting, of all people, opening up for the Grateful Dead? Well, this year, we found out.
I've never opened up for anyone in my life, but then this idea was floated across to me, and it was so out of left field and off the wall. But, yeah, I'll do that.
Some top acts found themselves reverting to rock clubs this year, either out of necessity, like the somewhat slumping Prince, or by occasional choice, like Aerosmith.
Lollapalooza, 93, we're rocking.
The third annual Lollapalooza tour may have been the most elaborate such package to date.
It's the biggest show that we've ever been able to do as far as reaching a lot of people.
The summer was also studded with one-off, day-long package concerts sponsored by various local radio stations.
Don't let it start, I've got a weak heart. It's a shame about rain.
It's time to fly, ain't no gas to woo that told me to tell you how.
Hey, I gotta get a picture for my mom, okay? Could y'all smile? Thanks.
And of course, wherever a handful of bands and a field full of kids gathered, there had to be a midway.
You need to be here doing this!
And another opportunity for allegedly cash-strapped concert-goers to spend even more money. A lot of money went to causes again this year, among them Farm Aid 6 and John Mellencamp's Concerts for the Heartland, which sought to assist flood-ravaged Midwesterners.
I go out and I do what I do, and then hopefully the money gets to the right place, and hopefully awareness is raised, and hopefully these people will find a little bit of relief.
And Nirvana, a band with a Croatian-American bassist, played a benefit show for Bosnian rape victims this year, and also started learning to love the big-time concert halls to which the chart-topping group had graduated.
There's nothing better than, you know, that much of a capacity of people, you know, in tune with the band and giving off that much energy. It's just like a little club, but 100 times more.
And the concerts just kept on coming. At year's end, Janet Jackson finally launched her long-awaited tour, as did the year's most charismatic band, Pearl Jam, two of several 1993 outings whose sounds will be echoing well into the new year. The year in tour is coming to an end right now with two great bands, Nirvana and Pearl Jam, still out on the road and packing them in.
In the world outside of pop music, 1993 ushered in a new administration and new chaos. As usual, young people played a part in the changing world around them, and here's a quick refresher.
I, William Jefferson Clinton.
It was a year of change in America, with President Bill Clinton speaking to a younger constituency.
This country's great challenge is to develop the capacities of everybody in America.
Clinton met the challenge with the signing of the National Service Plan. Soul Asylum were on hand, the first rock band to play a bill signing. Care was another defining issue for the president. First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton headed up a task force responsible for a new plan called the Health Security Act.
We're going to try to pass a law which will provide coverage for all Americans.
President Clinton also signed the so-called Motor Voter Bill, which automatically registers people to vote when applying for a driver's license.
We're taking strides to inform the American people, especially the young people, that, you know, their thoughts and their involvement does matter.
Janet Reno, Clinton's third choice for the job of Attorney General, became a hero to Americans by standing up and taking responsibility for the FBI's disastrous handling of the Waco, Texas siege.
Do you understand why you were a hero on that awful day?
I think people desperately want people to take responsibility, and I don't think any of us understood how much the American people want that to happen.
A split verdict came down in the civil case of the four police who beat Rodney King. Two of the officers, Stacy Kuhn and Lawrence Powell, were found guilty of using excessive force, and two were acquitted. In the case of Reginald Denny's trial, Damian Williams was acquitted for attempted murder and convicted of mayhem and assault. Henry Watson was found guilty of a misdemeanor and set free. Gays in the military dominated the headlines all year. Clinton backed out of his promise to lift the ban by compromising and allowing gays to serve if they did not advertise their sexual preference. The constitutionality of this move is still being questioned in court. Colorado made the news in 93 with the passing of Amendment 2, a new state law which denies homosexuals equal protection and rights.
Amendment 2 is found to be unconstitutional, and the court orders that the preliminary injunction be made permanent.
This year, Mother Nature took over with two of the worst disasters in centuries, flooding and fires. And acts of human terrorism came too close to home. The new world order that Clinton inherited is no order at all. American troops were sent into Somalia, Russia is still experiencing growing pains, and the civil war in Bosnia continues between the Serbs and the Croats. And this year saw an unanticipated peace treaty. Israel and the PLO formally recognized one another for the first time.
Signs of hope for the future.
We've still got the year in hip-hop doo-wop, the year in drag, and the year in weird coming up.
Enough apathy.
Enough ignorance.
Enough AIDS death.
Enough is enough.
Welcome back to the Year in Rock 93.
In past years, musical hybrids have made their mark. There was a fusion of rock and rap, and then jazz and rap, and this year R&B and hip-hop merged. The charts were filled with singing reminiscent of old street corner harmonies. Take a listen.
I call it hip-hop doo-wop. It's the new music of today.
Hip-hop doo-wop.
It's a black music thing right now.
Hip-hop doo-wop.
It's been a great year for R&B vocalists, given the popularity of the hip-hop doo-wop sound. This combination is made up of hip-hop beats, smoothed-out melodies, and some old-time rhythm and blues. This trend in music has been compared to an era gone by.
So it seems like groups and this style of singing, you know, with the old doo-wop harmony and, you know, doo-wop harmony against some of the 90s field music, you know, that's coming back around, you know.
Getting back to that point now, to where the singers are starting to really sing again. Boys to Men was one of the first male groups to actually start the new age trend of the old doo-wop style, so we'd like to thank them for that.
And on the female tip, En Vogue sort of introduced that to the industry, and we're really grateful to them because they proved to record companies that females can definitely sell records.
We wanted it to be music that would normally be for guys, so it could have that rough edge on it.
It's a reaction to
what's going on in hip-hop, which a lot of most popular groups are very aggressive and very misogynistic. And I think a lot of it, in my opinion, is a woman backlash in a way for more romantic material.
Like rap, hip-hop doo-wop became an expanding genre, and in time there were so many clones, it became difficult to distinguish one group from another.
I think what makes the group similar is the styling and the imaging.
I think us Silk H-Town got in under the wire, because now I think it's become a corporate thing where every record company wants to have a representative in this particular genre.
But will trend-following record companies kill hip-hop doo-wop by flooding the market with too many of these acts?
This would be stupid and ludicrous for me to believe that this type of thing will last forever, because people's tastes always change. People are fickle.
One group can't give you everything, so it's just, you know, it's enough room, there's enough money in the pot.
Right.
You know?
I wonder what hybrids we'll be listening to next year.
SWV and Silk were just a part of the passel of new acts clamoring for attention this year. Here are a few that succeeded in getting it.
But I'm a creep.
Dismissed by critics as a Pearl Jam rip, Stone Temple Pilots were one of the many new acts that exploded on the music scene, winning a Best New Act statuette at the MTV Video Music Awards show and selling 2 million copies of their debut album, Core.
Our music is about, you know, what we feel and not so much about having to describe a situation on the outside.
Some of the year's new groups were actually headed by familiar names from older bands.
A band, you've got to find people that are, you know, sensitive, that are funny. Then they have to be talented and have charisma. It didn't take me more than a week before I was back on the hunt, like, I've got to play.
I had a little bit of time as a solo artist last year when I was just Julianne Hatfield, and I didn't really feel comfortable getting all the attention.
And there were also acts that hit the big time in 1993, but only after years of anonymous struggle.
When we played our music, I mean, in our heads, I think we always envisioned, like, this was like rock and roll that could be like played on the radio and sort of like liked by like lots of different types of people.
It's time for me to just let everybody know who I am and what I sound like.
After its initial release a year ago, Blind Melon's debut album went to number 3 on the Billboard chart, thanks in part to...
I had a fun time working with the, oh my god, hunks, and these tutus, and tight, I'm all going, whoa!
People, if they go out and buy the album because of No Rain, they're going to be, maybe unpleasantly surprised that there's not another song on there that sounds like that.
And of course, in rap, it was a year in which fresh new styles continued to proliferate.
But I'm cool like that. I'm cool like that. I'm
if you look
cool
at Jacob O'Planets, we chill. We manipulate, you know, slang and language. We use a lot of, you know, jazz samples, a lot of fat beats. And just by virtue of being, you know, us as individuals, that's what makes us different.
His plan was like this. Our show was energized, you know what I'm saying? We got mad energy. We've been cooped up for a long time. Now we got our chance to be in the light, so now we're going to energize with everybody.
Well, there you have it, some newish faces of 1993.
We're in the home stretch now. On the way, we've got a look at Kurt's report on penis pruning, Prince's identity crisis, and Beavis and Butthead, all of which really sums up how weird this year has been, and the king of weird, Michael Jackson.
But first, maybe the most stylish new act of the year was RuPaul, the 6-foot-plus drag queen who captured the hearts of dance club kids, magazine writers, talk show hosts, and just about everybody else, with the possible exception of Milton Berle. Thanks to RuPaul, cross-dressing, an inclination previously associated with people of the English persuasion, became not so big a deal in this country. Take a look.
I have one thing to say.
Work it, work it, work, work, work it, work it, work, work it, work it, work, work, work.
I think drag is so popular right now because drag queens are heralding the new coming of love.
I think cross-dressing, I think it's been there since the beginning of time.
I know all there is to know about the crying.
Everyone's having a sex change. What's going on?
Now praying. Praying, girl. Now praying.
I personally like to wear dresses, and I wear them around the house sometimes.
If that's a man, I'm prison eyes now.
Don't be throwing no shade. I just want to get paid. Don't be throwing no shade. I just want to get paid. Hello.
During the 80s, it was colorless. And now people are busting out. You know, the pendulum swung so far to the right, it's going to come crashing back to the left, okay?
You better work.
MTV cordially invites you to blow off 1993 with the loudest, wildest party we've ever thrown. First, it's MTV's Live and Loud with your host, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Anthony and Flea, and incredible live sets by The Breeders, Cypress Hill, and Nirvana. Then, the party gets even hotter with Janet's New Year Jam. Ring in the new year with Janet Jackson, live from Madison Square Garden. Plug into MTV's Live and Loud, followed by Janet's New Year Jam. The party starts at 10, New Year's Eve, only on MTV.
MTV's The Year in Rock is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately?
After years on the road, some small cars find themselves in a tight spot. But of all the small cars built in the past 12 years, more Escorts are still on the road than any other. And when you realize that Escort is thousands of dollars less than the leading imports, and offers four models for the same low price, it's easy to see how the competition stacks up. Ford Escort.
Some days it seems like everyone's out to get you. I mean, it can be overwhelming. An STD program pad. Devastating. STD's pre-programmed moves give you more than a fighting chance. STD's program pad. Raw power in your hands.
Now that your work is finished, what are you going to do?
I'm going to Wonderland.
Our best holiday ever.
Enjoy this holiday season with Wonderland. It's fun for the whole family.
The staff and management of all the Wonderlands wish everyone a wonderful holiday and a great new year.
Hutchins Final 93 event. Final markdown pickup, $73.90. 5094 Central is the lowest price ever. Every Toyota posted with final markdown prices.
It's easy.
To compare for the lowest price in the state, VTP King Caps, 4x4s, King Cap 4x4s, and hundreds of used vehicles with prices posted. Dozens of below Blue Book wholesale.
Plus, in the other dealers, below retail price.
Tercel's and pickup, $77.88. And sale only fixed rate, 5.99% on new and many used vehicles. Hutchins Final 93 event. Dozens of loaded new Toyotas and Nissans under $10,000.
Happy, beautiful little scene with a lot of color in it. Very easy that you can do.
There we go.
Okay, let's just put a happy little mountain, something about like that.
And let's paint several little happy trees.
And push. Look at there.
There.
MTV, the land of happy little trees.
Mercy, come on.
Welcome back to the Year in Rock 93.
Been a hell of a year for Michael Jackson. Started out with a new open Michael and ended up in quite a different way.
I don't read all the things written about me. I wasn't aware that the world thought I was so weird and bizarre. But when you grow up as I did in front of 100 million people since the age of 5, you're automatically different.
Michael Jackson started the year with a personal appearance campaign to alter his public image as an eccentric and troubled recluse. A campaign that collapsed in August when a 13-year-old boy filed sexual battery charges against him.
We are conducting a criminal investigation at this point.
Jackson's response to the lawsuit was that his accuser's father had attempted to extort $20 million from him. The singer stayed abroad, continuing his world tour while police searched his Los Angeles homes. Some of his preteen friends came to his defense, although they too noted they had shared beds with Jackson. Drama queen Elizabeth Taylor rushed to the singer's side, and his family pledged their support from afar. As the scandal deepened, the star himself had less and less to say.
Mr. Jackson, do you have anything to say about the allegations? Mr. Jackson, do you want to say anything to your fans?
Jackson's world tour grew increasingly strange. There were problems almost everywhere, and in South America, Jackson was photographed with two young boys who were traveling with him and holding up a copy of the magazine called Child.
Tell me, what will I do?
Finally, with a concert date looming in Puerto Rico, on U.S. territory, Jackson suddenly canceled the rest of his world tour, claiming he'd become addicted to painkillers prescribed after scalp surgery for an accident that had occurred a decade earlier.
My friends and doctors advised me to seek professional guidance immediately in order to eliminate what has become an addiction.
With his tour canceled and his multi-million dollar promotional deal with Pepsi-Cola at an end, Jackson flew from Mexico to Europe, pointedly avoiding any touchdown on U.S. soil, and disappeared for 2 weeks before finally turning up in a London rehab clinic. Back in L.A., his lawyers denied that he was avoiding any return to the U.S. for fear of legal action.
The fact that Puerto Rico was U.S. territory had nothing to do with the decision to cancel the balance of his tour. He could easily have just canceled Puerto Rico if that's what he wanted.
Whatever Jackson may have wanted, it certainly wasn't the tabloid circus that his case quickly became. L.A. police declined to comment on reports that they were prepared to strip search the star to confirm his 13-year-old accuser's description of distinctive genital markings. And five former Jackson bodyguards filed suit against the singer, claiming they'd been let go because they knew too much about his activities with young boys. And a judge finally ordered the civil case to go to trial on March 21st. Then, just when things couldn't get more bizarre, Jackson's sister LaToya made a startling announcement.
Michael is my brother. I love him a great deal. But I cannot, and I will not, be a silent collaborator of his crimes against small, innocent children.
And it makes me feel really sad that my own daughter's out there trying to send her brother down the river because she got some money-hungry Mongol husband out there and herself just trying to make money off of his downfall.
Michael Jackson then very quietly slipped back into the United States and on December 22nd spoke publicly for the first time and described in graphic detail the police body search he underwent.
It was a nightmare, a horrifying nightmare. But if this is what I have to endure to prove my innocence, my complete innocence, so be it. There have been many disgusting statements made recently concerning allegations of improper conduct on my part. These statements about me are totally false. I am totally innocent of any wrongdoing, and I know these terrible allegations will all be proven false.
Who knew Michael Jackson would have this kind of year?
Well, Michael Jackson's tabloid adventures weren't the weirdest thing going on this year, really.
I don't think it's enough gun.
Oops, I had a blackout.
No, no, do not adjust your head. That was only 1993 barreling by. Another year... of living...
Hey, let me just fix this here a second.
Stupidly. Where to begin? With Prince, who responded to slumping superstardom by changing his name to some strange symbol that nobody could pronounce? Or new age stud Sting, who announced that he was able to have sex for a grueling 8 straight hours?
I can only demonstrate. I can't really verbalize it.
I'm at a loss for words.
In England, Whitney Houston's greatest hit was so ubiquitous that one woman was jailed for playing the thing so incessantly, and another had her stereo heaved out a window by a diva-weary neighbor. In talk show land, the other end. Chevy Chase made the mistake of thinking he was still funny.
How hard can this be?
It was the kind of year in which Senator Ernest Hollings launched an impassioned attack on MTV's Beavis and Butthead without ever having seen the show.
We got this, what is it, Buffcoat and Beaver, or Beaver and something else they had. I haven't seen it. I don't watch it. But whatever it is.
Dumbass.
And an aging beefball named Joey Buttafuoco finally admitted he'd had sex with a 16-year-old, and his equally classy brother, a rock band manager, had his group whip up some tunes about the tryst and then pitched a video to MTV. Reigning over tabloid hell along with Buttafuoco this year was Lorena Bobbitt, the angry manicurist who pruned her husband's penis down to a 1-inch stump. Said he, it hurt real bad. Yeah! It was also a year in which PC hysteria reached new heights of inanity at Ohio's Antioch College, which ordered formal new rules of negotiation for those about to make out.
It wasn't hard enough to get laid in college.
It was a year in which grown men lived in fear of pint-sized paparazzophobe Shannon Doherty.
I am not a bitch.
Of suspiciously sharp-featured media curiosity LaToya Jackson, and for that matter, her chair-throwing husband-slash-manager Jack Gordon, who, like his occasionally battered wife, appeared to have a mailing address somewhere on the moon.
10 years ago, LaToya was Michael Jackson's sister. Today, LaToya is the most recognized girl in the entire world.
Thanks of a grateful nation went out to inventor Norman Williams for his contribution to urban self-defense, the world's first combination beeper and 22 Magnum mini bazooka.
You can nonchalantly, you know, just do that and blow their head off.
1993 was the year in which Baywatch, with 1 billion viewers worldwide, became the most popular series in TV history. And lead breast Pamela Anderson let the world in on what she's really into as, like, a person.
Incense and candles and astrological forecasts and young philosophies.
Guns N' Roses bassist Duff McKagan,
I hate cough,
joined his new wife in a skin mag shoot.
Now I'm rock and roll.
And you remember Tina Turner's ex, Ike.
I only punched her with my fist once.
Of course, there were occasional pebbles of eloquence strewn across the year's endless acres of media blather.
Stop the insanity!
Without oxygen, you die.
Also notably eloquent this year was Pearl Jam frontman and conscience of rock, Eddie Vedder.
Yeah. Just shut up and sing, Eddie.
But even the extraordinary Vedder can't yet hold a candle to that master of metal discourse, Ozzy Osbourne, whose own feelings as 1993 collapsed in a year-end heap probably summed it up for all of us.
I'm like a sleeping volcano, you know. It's like I have a little outburst, sort of major outburst.
Well, there you have it. Yet another weird year.
And a new one's about to begin.
Brace yourself. We'll see you in 94.
Hello. Drive up. Drive on.
And I got plastic socks on, so I can't electrocute myself.
This is getting awfully personal, Tabitha.
Oh. Don't you make the rules, Kurt?
Well, no. No.
Kurt, you don't make the rules?
No, I don't.
Should I?
Maybe I should.
Sure. Should.
Hey, it's great. Let's go around and do it again.
I refuse to work with anybody who's not a genius.
We could turn this into a psychoanalysis kind of a thing, but I don't think we have time today, so.
Previously on The Real World.
Television, the drug of a nation.